we're known for. What is our vision? What is the mission of the university? What are our goals? And the thing that I found pretty quickly is that we had a lot of different answers. So if I asked 10 deans the same question of, what is the university's priorities, I got 10 different answers, sometimes 12 because they had more than one. So it was one of those things where I learned really quickly that we need to gather together and begin to sing off the same page, or we were never going to be able to position ourselves in the marketplace as a unique institution because we didn't know the unique things and characteristics that really supported and made WVU what makes WVU. So, to go through some of the challenges that I found that we were going to have to face is that we had very inconsistent or non-existent messaging. So across the board, we were all saying different things. We had different priorities. We didn't know exactly what the university stood for and what we should say. If somebody asked us in 30 seconds, describe WVU, we could do it. We also were unclear on our priorities, as I mentioned before. Everyone had a different agenda. So we need to be able to come together as one university to really begin to say, what is our priority and what are we going to message time and time again? We also could not define our strengths. Everyone had a different answer for that too. So we really need to begin to focus on what are those areas, those key leadership areas that's going to set WVU apart from everyone else out in the marketplace of higher ed. We really needed to begin to think about that. We had a very cumbersome internal communication process. We had lots of good tools, but they were being used in a variety of ways. So we needed to really look at that foundation of what we had and bring it together in a really cohesive way to make sure that the messages that we were sending out got to the intended audiences. We had moderate involvement with retention and recruitment. And that's one area that I think in university relations we have to be more heavily involved, because it's not just about sending out view books and throwing out some TV ads. It's really about the strategy of how do you recruit the best students to WVU? How do you recruit the students that have the talents that really fit our programs? How do you begin to really message those? And we needed to look at our student, because we have very different student populations coming from out of state and in state. We're about 50-50. But even with in state, we have very different needs within the states of our students that live within the state. They have very different questions and very different needs, so we needed to look at that. And then we had an external brand that was tied to athletics and a party image, and we're going to go a little bit more into that as we move on. So within about the first 3 months, this is the list I came up with. As we have a good foundation, but we have some real challenges ahead that we're going to need to tackle before we can really launch a new brand. So the opportunities is that we really needed to focus in on that consistent messaging. We're streamlined and increased our internal communication. My team hears this from me time and time again, family first. We tell our internal audience first before we ever take it externally. And we sometimes flipped that, where people would hear, oh, I saw in the paper that we're doing this now. Never want our internal, never want our faculty, staff, and students to hear about something in the paper. They need to hear it from us first. We needed to improve our relationships and increase our communication with the media. So we had a habit of having this fantastic website where we wrote lots of great stories and put them on there, and then expected the media to come and gather from there. Well, we all know that media are overworked and underpaid and doing three jobs in one, right? So how do we begin to craft the stories that we want to put in their hands and create a fantastic package that they really don't have to do much work, but it gets our message out there in a great way? Needed to define our strengths, be more involved in the strategy development for retention and recruitment, and then really help define that new brand for the institution. So what will a strong brand do for us? If we do it right, it's going to help define ourselves in the marketplace. It's going to differentiate ourselves in the marketplace, and it's also going to help us deliver a really great experience. And I've done lots of talks with our folks around campus because lots of times people they're not really sure what a brand is. And there's still even a question, should higher education even be in the brand marketing sphere, right? They feel that people should just know to come to West Virginia University and that's all we have to tell them. But the fact is we do have to tell folks why we're different. We have to tell prospective faculty members what makes us great. So there is a reason for higher ed to be in the brand and the marketing arena. And I know I'm singing to the choir here, but a lot of times when I was talking with folks, they would say, oh, we have a brand, it's this. And they would repeat to me a tagline that the campus had used, you know, 10 years earlier. So there's lots of confusion behind what is a tagline, what is the creative campaign, and what is really your brand? And as we know, the brand is really, it's the essence of everything. It's that total experience that we create for all of our audiences. And that was another thing I found pretty quickly, is that we had what I call a one-size-fits-all strategy. So whatever the message was, we were sending it out to the same people or to different audiences at times at the same time in the same way. We didn't segment our audiences at all. We didn't tailor the message for what they wanted to receive. We really just shot out the same things across the board. And what I've been telling folks as we really begin to roll this out is if we do things right, the brand will really help us do five things, right? It's going to help us to make good on the promises that we make to our audiences. So it's really imperative that if we make a promise, we follow through. Because we all know here that it's that relationship that we build with people. And if we're not showing them the things that they expect and that we promise we would deliver, then we lose that trust. The brand is also the essence of our institution. So we're part of the Big 12, but we're very different than all the other institutions that are in the Big 12. What is the essence of WVU and how are we different from everyone else? It's the experience we create, it's the personality that we convey, and it's also the message we deliver. And we have to make sure that we get that message down very clearly and concisely so that we can all speak it at the same time. And great brands are built in a clear position and a great story, and we had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of great stories, right? But what we didn't have is a clear position. And how did we want to send those messages out? And how did we want those messages to impact or influence people? So we can have all the great stories in the world, but if we don't use them in the right ways, they get lost. So we really began to sit around and think, where are the areas that we want to promote? What are the messages that we want to send? And what stories can help us supplement that? So how do we tell a great story? Well, I always say that it's the emotional and intellectual connections. I also describe it as the head and the heart, right? So they have to understand and connect with us up here. They have to understand intellectually what we offer, what we do, who we are. But we also have to connect with their heart. They have to feel something. There has to be a reason they want to build that relationship with us, that they want to keep coming back and returning to WVU. So we have to really make sure that we hit them, if you will, in both places. We have to hit them in the head and we have to hit them in the heart with who we are and what makes us better and different and special. So our good stories help build meaningful relationships, and I just alluded to that really that's what it's all about. So when you all finish here, you do know that you're all going to be my brand ambassadors, right? So you're going to be out there helping me to spread the story of WVU. And it is about that one-to-one connection. So as, for example, if we take a look at recruitment, I can send the best of you book, the prettiest ads on TV, I can do all of that. But when those prospective students and their families get to campus and they experience us and they meet with someone one-on-one, if they don't connect and begin to build a meaningful relationship with that person and with this institution, all the print materials and all the ad campaigns won't matter. It's about that connection and that relationship. And the best stories are authentic. So when my team and I begin to really think about how do we look at a new brand and how do we begin to define that, they begin to talk about, do we want to be like Penn State? Do we want to be like Indiana University, whatever it may be. And my thought was, no, we don't want to be like anyone else. We want to be authentic to who we are. And that's really core to any marketing and branding message out there. It is not about trying to reach and be like someone else. It's not like trying to catch up to someone else. It's about being true to who you are, presenting that authentic message, and then letting those who really understand and connect with that come into your fold. So a great experience really helps us create alignment. Dr. Gee, who's been here a little over a year and a half as well, he is really big on talking about one WVU. He talks a lot about when he arrived, he felt there were lots of different silos within the university. And that happens really with any corporation, right? At some point you begin to silo yourself out. Even within university relations, when I first landed here, we had a fantastic team, have a fantastic team. But what I learned really quickly is that we were really in our segments. We were either in video or we were in news or we were in design. And what I needed them to be is working all together as one. I talk to them a lot and say that I don't use your title, I use your talent. And we want to make sure that if you have a talent that can help benefit the university and benefit our team, then we're going to use that whether you're a designer or a writer or a photographer. Having a great brand experience will help boost our reputation too. So it really helps begin to get our words out there and get our messages out there and help elevate the brand awareness. Increase our loyalty. We have a very enthusiastic and loyal alumni base, but I want to make sure that even those who perhaps didn't graduate from here have a sense of loyalty to the institution, that they understand what we're about and they connect with it and they maintain that loyalty as well. Also, it will help us engage with our audiences. And again, it's all about that engagement. It's about that one-on-one connection and really making sure that people who engage with us and come and see us and visit and talk, that they leave knowing that we're something different and that they want a spot here in the university in some way or fashion. And it will help us build consistency. And as I mentioned earlier, that is one thing that we really lacked. We had a lot of messages and a lot of things going on across the board, and we really needed to bring it together. So how did we get here? Well, this is a really bad photo, wrong one, next screen. So this is our competition, right? So this is how we got here, because I am facing this slide plus hundreds of other colleges and universities out there for the same student. So I really need to think about how do we present ourselves to attract that student and make them look at us versus another college or institution. This is a slide I met. This is a bad slide because it's stuff that I pulled out of my drawer that when I first arrived here, I began to kind of gather together. And as you can see, we were all over the board when it came to our materials. We had different fonts, different photography, clip art, even the Flying WV, although a very well recognized mark, was used in a lot of different ways and always not the appropriate way. So how do we begin to really bring that together and say, okay, time out. We need to really look at this, and if we're going to present an image, it has to be a unified image. So when we began the whole branding experience and taking a look at how we really began to brand ourselves, we had four core objectives, okay? The first is that we wanted to tell an authentic story that really promotes WVU's quality, relevance, and prominence. Second is that we wanted to inspire internal audiences to take part in this story. Again, it's what I alluded to earlier, that it's really important to me that the faculty, staff, and students of WVU and the alumni of WVU, that we understand our story first so that we can help spread the news and spread the information. And also, I wanted folks to understand, too, that what a brand can do for a university, that without this, we're going to be behind because we're not out in the field doing what we need to be doing. The third objective was to give multiple external audiences, especially our prospective students and West Virginians, a very clear reason to believe in and advocate for WVU. And our fourth objective was to develop a brand that feels authentic and it would be exciting and that Mountaineers would really want to rally behind and really help promote. So it was a five-step process that we took to get through the branding experience and help to create the creative campaign. The first is that we did research, lots and lots of research. I'm a big believer that you have to have that if you're going to go out and do anything different or change your course. You need to have the data to prove why you need to do that. So we did our research. We developed then the messaging strategy in step two. In step three, we developed concepts for the brand. Three or four, we began to package those concepts into a creative campaign. And then fifth is we began the implementation. So we're going to step back a little bit and take a look at how we did the research. So we surveyed over 3,000 people, and that included our current students, prospective students, parents of prospective students, as well as alumni, faculty, staff, and administration. So we had a wide-ranging survey that really talked about what are the things that make us different, what are the things that you think hinder us, where would you like to see us in the next 5 to 10 years. We asked our surveyed folks lots of different questions to help us get a gauge of where we were. We also did what I call 25 in-depth interviews, and that was with 25 campus administrators and leaders, as well as alumni leaders, not only within the state, but also out of state. And the questions we asked of them, you know, were the same things of what makes us different and why, you know, why are we, how should we begin to differentiate ourselves, but it was also what keeps you up at night? What makes you worry about this institution? The sorts of things that we can begin to, if we address, begin to really change some of those worries and put us in a different trajectory. We did 10 focus groups, so as we began to really develop the brand and develop some creative concepts, I wanted to make sure that whatever we came out with resonated with people. That wasn't just because I liked it, but it's because it really speaks to what a Mountaineer and what a WVU person connects with. So the 10 focus groups really helped us take a look at what we were developing and let us know if we were on the mark or off the mark. And then for our internal and external audiences, we divided those in a couple different ways. So internal audiences, of course, our campus community and our alumni base. But the external audiences, we have a segment that we use typically, especially in the recruitment area, which includes Virginia, Ohio, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and Maryland. But we added some additional states in there because I was curious to see past, if you go a little further west, you know, we're in the Big 12 now, we've been playing the sports with our Big 12 peers for a while, are we gaining any recognition? And especially in states where we have a high alumni base, is there any brand awareness there for us? And so we added in Illinois, Indiana, Texas, and Tennessee as well to see if we were going beyond the borders at all. So there were 10 insights that we gained as we got the research back. The first is that we understand the true meaning of the word land grant. So the folks who did the research with us, they've worked with lots of big universities who are in the land grant realm, and they said that of all of those that they've worked with, WVU seemed to understand the true meaning of what it means to be a land grant university, that we believe and we're passionate about that mission that we give back to the state, that we have a mission to impact those that we serve. And so for them, that was really a driving point that we should make clear that we're not here just to hand out diplomas, but we're here to make a difference, and how do we do that? Two is that we needed to sharpen the message. So they felt there was an opportunity to really help reacquaint people, both West Virginians and those in the region, with the university and all the things that we do, and help them understand again, what is our redefined purpose, and why are we here, and how is that different than other institutions they may be familiar with. Three is that it's time to speak up. So they said that West Virginians aren't known as a boastful bunch, and that is true. So I come from Indiana. I spent several years at Purdue University. And before I came here, certainly the crowd at Purdue, they were very eager to share what they were doing and how great they were. What I found when I came to West Virginia is that we are kind of a quiet bunch, that we don't want to boast too much about what we do. In fact, several people told me, well, don't go out and do a big TV commercial about that because we don't want to brag. Or don't, you know, promote that in too big of a way. And I remember saying, why am I here? That's what I'm here to do, is really begin to show all the great things that we do at West Virginia University. But it goes back to being authentic. We want to do it in a way that feels good to us, but at the same time doesn't diminish who we are. So number three was that we really need to begin to speak up about the great things that are happening. Number four is that there's room for fun. So this goes to our party image, right? So when I first got here, I often heard we're just a party school. Oh, we can't attract the best faculty because we're a party school. We can't attract the best students because we're a party school. Everything that we couldn't do was because we were a party school. Well, guess what? So is IU, so is Wisconsin, so is Michigan State, right? There's lots of folks out there who have that party school image, but what was different about us here at WV is that we owned it, and we perpetuated it, and we began to believe our own bad press. And so it was really critical that with this brand, we began to think, it's okay to have fun. We want to teach our students balance. We should all have balance in our own lives, right? But it's not okay to take that a bit further and say we're just a party school. So we have here on the screen that we began to convey and talk about play hard and work hard. And we've tweaked that even further. Dr. Gee's message now when he goes out and talks to students is work smart, play smart. Okay? So we don't want to give up the idea that we are a fun university, that we do have a different culture, and that we do have a good time. But we want to make sure, too, that they understand that that doesn't diminish the academic quality that we deliver here. And in no way should we go around saying that we're just a party school. And if someone says that to us, we need to be prepared to fight back and say, that's not actually true, and not just take the hits. Number five is that we have a big school with a small feel. So a lot of schools say they do, but we actually deliver on that. There are lots of ways that we bring our Mountaineer community in and really make them feel part of the family. One of the ways that we demonstrate this when we have prospective students coming in is that we have them all gather in the Coliseum so they can see how they kind of fit in this really big space, which represents the big university. And then they go off and meet with their departments and their colleges and schools and begin to feel that family feel where that connection will really be made. So it's really important that we continue to talk about the family feel and that we take care of each other here and that we're not going to let people fail and that our ultimate goal is to see every student who comes here succeed. Number six, putting academics in the spotlight. So for a long time, we talked a lot about the spirit of the institution. In our view books and our materials, you might hear a lot about the Mountaineer and see imagery of that. And what we really need to do was flip that on its head. We had to make sure that every single communication that was going out, especially when aimed at prospective students, talked about our academics, talked about the fabulous faculty, talked about our students who do fantastic things. We really needed to begin to flip that spin a little bit. So one of the things that we're really focusing on is as we begin to take out this campaign, we're focusing on our people, and we're focusing on the accomplishments. Number seven is the Mountaineer spirit, but at the same time, we don't want to lose our Mountaineer spirit, right? We don't want to lose the essence of the institution. So it's really important that as we define this new brand and as we really talk about our academics, we also talk about the spirit in the right form. So as I mentioned before, some of our academic materials showed lots of imagery of the Mountaineer, and I very politely said, I love the Mountaineer, but it needs to go back to athletics. We really need to see our labs. We need to see our faculty engage with our students. We need to really show that academic experience so they know that they're going to get that first and foremost, and then they're going to have fun at a football game. So we're flipping that over just a little bit. Number eight, different audiences have different needs. And it's really critical that we begin to recognize this because we have lots of different audiences that we need to address, which we'll talk a bit of how we divided those up. But just as an example, it's really critical that if we're recruiting students from out of state, they have a different message and a different need they need to have to receive than we do our in-state. And I go a step further and say that our in-state students are even a little different. Our northern West Virginia students have different questions and needs than our southern West Virginia students. So we have to be really conscious of who we're talking to, what that student's question is, what their parents' questions are, and how do we begin to really get the right messages to them. Number nine is that we are West Virginia's university. So one thing, when you hear Dr. Gee talk tonight, he will talk a lot about how we are the one institution that needs to be in the hearts and minds of all 1.8 million West Virginians. He wants to make sure that when someone asks if they're from West Virginia, what's your university, they say West Virginia University. And it goes even deeper because we have a really great bond with our state, and we want to make sure that continues and builds even deeper. And how can we begin to impact? We often say that if one rises, the other rises with us. We're not in it to compete. We're in it to make sure that both the state and the university do well together. So we're really tied to that relationship. And the last is that we need to believe in ourselves. So across all messages tested, prospects consistently gave higher ratings while faculty and staff were consistently lower. And we have to believe in who we are before we can ever ask people outside of WVU to believe in us. And that goes back a little bit to what I had sort of begun to hear and feel as I was talking with folks, is that we had begun to really believe our own bad press. And we didn't think we were as good as other institutions. And we didn't think that people should come here and have their full careers here. We really felt this was often a starting ground or just, you know, a university that can compete with the Marshalls and the Bluefields of West Virginia. We can compete with them, but we can compete with a much bigger and broader base. And so part of this whole campaign is not only talking about all the fabulous things that we do here, but it's about instilling a belief in our own faculty, staff, our own WVU family, that we are worthy, if you will, of all of these things that we do, and it's okay to talk about them and really share them in a big way. So those 10 insights that we gained, we'll talk now about how that really began to impact our brand positioning. So the first implication is that we do have a history of excellence in discovery and innovation here at WVU. So how do we begin to really ramp that up and share that with people? We're leading critical research and initiatives that move our state forward. We're giving our students the opportunity at the undergrad level to participate in those. So how do we begin to really share that and talk about it in a big way? The second implication is that as part of our purpose as a land-grant university, we serve as an economic engine for the state of West Virginia. And we work really hard to improve the lives of its citizens. So again, that goes back to that relationship that we have. This is a big part of our brand and of our campaign. Implication number three is that we are committed to high-quality academics and world-changing work. And again, this speaks back to flipping that message, that we don't want to diminish the spirit of the institution, but we really need to raise and elevate the academics and how we begin to position that in the marketplace with all the other institutions. And the fourth implication is that there's a rugged determination that defines our spirit and our culture. It's what drives our focus on impact. And with it, we're intrinsically hardworking and fearless in the face of obstacles. So one of the things that our researchers asked folks in the focus group and in the surveys is, can you describe what it means to be a Mountaineer? Can you describe WVU? And people had a really hard time. They would say, I don't know, it's just something I feel in here. I don't know, it's just there's just something special about this place. So it was really important for me that we figure out a way to put those feelings that people had a hard time describing into words that we could describe ourselves with. And rugged determination is two of the words that we really came down to, that we do have this sort of tenacity about us, that we never give up and we keep going no matter what. We're determined, and that it's okay to have maybe something not work out and maybe it didn't go the way we want, but it's all right, we keep plugging until we do. So that rugged determination is something that you'll see forth in all the different things that we do. There we go. Okay. So where we are now. So all of the things that we talked about, all of the insights that we learned from our research, how that impacts our brand positioning, it all comes down to three things, okay? The first is what we do. What we do every day is academic engagement and excellence. We push that academic message forward in everything that we do. The second is what we deliver, which defines that world-changing discovery and innovation, all the different entrepreneurial things that we do. Those are the things why we do all the academic and excellence. We do it because we want to impact and change the world. And why we matter is because we're an economic and social engine for the state. So we think and work towards great academics, we work on important discoveries, and all for the good of the state, and we do it all comes together in the middle with that spirit of rugged determination. Okay? So we talked a little bit about audiences, and before I said we kind of just shot everything out to everybody at the same time. What we did is really define our audiences for us so that we could help communicators, especially within our colleges and schools, help them figure out what they needed to be sending and to whom at the right times. So internally we have our campus community, as well as our alumni and donors and friends. So those who've been a part of WVU, those who've experienced this, those are the folks that we consider our internal audience. But externally, we broke it down into five categories. So we have our in-state prospective students and their influencers. We have their external or out-of-state and international prospective students and their influencers. We have West Virginians. So we want to make sure that those who live and work in West Virginia, they understand the university and its goals as well. Our employers and business leaders, as well as our government and policymakers. And I can give you one example of how we really began to tweak things earlier this year when we went into our legislative session. In the past, I heard lots of rumblings of, I don't know what we're doing down in Charleston. I don't know what the causes are. I don't know what we're championing. I don't know if anyone is down there on my behalf speaking for my college or school. So one thing that we really did is worked really hard on that internal communication piece as well as our external. So we had a newsletter that went out weekly to our internal leaders that talked about what happened in Charleston that week, what was coming up, and how the university was positioning itself. And then externally, we did a lot of work with our legislators to tell them, here are some of the great things that are happening at WVU. Oh, this is on the floor. Well, let me tell you how WVU helps handle some of these issues. So it was really a well-coordinated event. We worked very closely with our government relations staff. And when they needed things turned on a dime, we turned it on a dime because we knew that it was that sort of environment that we had to move quickly. And it made a world of difference this year. Personality. So I talked in the beginning, really early, that we have a personality as a university. So how would we describe ourselves if we saw WVU walking down the street? What kind of personality would they have? So it came down to six characteristics, five of which we had used in the past, but one that was added that was new. First, we're a pioneering spirit. We are resourceful and entrepreneurial. We also are innovative. We do cutting-edge work, and we think forward, and we try and figure out new ways to stay ahead of the curve. We're also grounded, and this was the new personality trait that was added. We're unpretentious and we're real. And that goes back to that authentic personality, right? We don't want to be like anyone else. We're not going to try and be like anyone else. We want to be exactly who we are. We own our personality, and we're okay with that. So grounded is another term that we added because we thought it really helped define West Virginia University. We're also passionate. We have a legacy of being fiercely loyal in a very spirited community. We're tireless, hardworking, and determined. And we're also caring. We not only care for the external audiences that we have, but we also care for each other. And we support each other in a really big way. So caring was another attribute that I think was really strong that came through the research. So the spirit of the brand. So if we've done our research right, and if we have done the work and really formed a great platform, we should have a brand that really resonates and speaks to the spirit of WVU. So I'm going to click out here and get a file that we've developed what I call a trailer, if you will, that brings all of this together in a visual way.
First means we're bold enough for big ideas and smart enough to launch them. That's why we go to the edge. And instead of going back, we build a bridge and we keep going. We go forth into a world of untapped energy ready to be unearthed. Unproven theories waiting to be unlocked and unwritten journeys ready to unfold. These are the next frontiers. The new frontiers. Frontiers that will lead us to new cures. New laws, and new possibilities, all bound to lead our state and our country to a better quality of life. So we will go above, we will go beyond, and when everyone else goes back, Mountaineers go first. Let's go.
I was just going to ask, how did that make you feel? But I'm going to take that as a good sign if you all clap. So, but I'm still going to put the question out there. I'm going to stop talking for a few minutes, and I want to hear from the crowd. How did you've seen the research that went into this? You saw the implications and our insights. Do you feel that this really came together that represents WVU? And if so, how did it make you feel? Yes.
I'm a two-time graduate of WVU, and I saw the video before today. And when I saw it, I knew it was right on point without having seen all the background. It gave me chills, and I was proud to be an Mountaineer.
Great. That's exactly what we were hoping for. So good. Anyone else?
I felt yes. Really inspired. Like she said, I'm also now a two-time graduate. Morgantown's my home, and I really think it really encompassed everything that this university offers. It can be intimidating that it is such a big school, but you made a great point that it's such a small community. like I hope I can work at the university one day. It's a great place to be.
It is. Good. I'm glad you said it. And you're right. I mean, for me, having never been in West Virginia before, when they approached me about the position and I came here and interviewed, it was love at first sight. And there is something I said, I don't know how we can market a hug, but it's like West Virginia hugs you, right? They just bring you in and there's something about it that really just connects with people. And that's what we want to try and convey, that it is different. I know every university out there says we're different, but we are. And so how do we really begin to express that and show that? And hopefully, as we roll out this campaign in different ways, people will begin to connect. Let me go back here. Okay, so we'll talk a little bit. So one of the things that we've done in the past is that we've sort of had the same voice. We had what I called a very institutional voice. It was always very formal sentences and everything was, you know, very prim and proper. But when it really comes to talking, if we had a conversation, we would not be very prim and proper, right? We would talk as we would normally talk. And so we really want to begin to look at the brand and have a different voice. So we have five tips for our writers who are working with us out there, and one is that we want to be confident without being arrogant, because confidence is what we want to begin to portray, right? We want to be sure that people understand that we know who we are and that we're confident in what we do, but we also don't want to be arrogant because that's not authentic to who we are as an institution. So for example, people might write, going first means we're bold enough for big ideas and smart enough to launch them. We would not want to write, be the smartest person in the room, right? So we don't want to be arrogant that way, but we want to inspire people. Second is we want to be bold without being aggressive. Again, it goes back to our personality and what feels good to us in our heart. We might write, innovation will be forged by the fearless, instead of innovation will be forged when you stop waiting and start going. So again, it's really subtle. And for those of us who write, we know that those little subtleties are the things that really set us apart. And so we've been working with our teams across campus to really help them develop that writing style, because it's very, very different than what we've done before. Three is that we want to be direct without feeling trite. So we want to say, this is where ideas come first. We don't want to say, ideas matter. Okay, so again, it's about being direct. It's about telling people what we do here without making them feel like, yeah, I knew that. Tip number four is we want to be challenging without being implausible. So we don't want to say things that people won't believe, but we do want them to be challenged and to think, this is a place that's going to challenge you, that's going to push you past places you thought you might be able to go. So what kind of language can you use that inspires that? So for example, writers might write, leaps and bounds belong only to the bold and the brave, instead of change the world starting now. So you know you're not going to change it right now, right? But what kinds of things might you do that eventually will get you to where you will change the world, where you will make something different and have an impact in a life? And then five is that we want to be inspirational without being sentimental. And within our team, we say halftime speech, not Hallmark card, right? So we want to rally, we want to make people feel good, but we don't necessarily want to be too sentimental and sappy. So again, it's the future will be built by those who are willing to get up and go after it, versus the future is where your dreams meet preparation. So again, it's real subtle, and it's something that our team's working on across the whole university of how do we begin to really write this in a little bit different way. From our graphic language, nothing's changing. So people would ask me, are you changing the fly in WVU or WV? And I'm like, are you crazy? There's no way I'm going to change that. So that's a mark that people resonate with and they love. And what we wanted to do is make sure as we moved into this new brand, that people were able to keep some things, not everything has to be redone, right? And this is a mark that really resonates, that really expresses who we are as an institution, so nothing is changing with that. So tagline, we've had a history here at WVU of having different taglines, and then we've tagged everything to death. So people, when I first said, I want us to have a tagline again, they were like, no, please, we don't have taglines here. But I'm like, yes, they can be very, very useful and powerful if you use them in the right way and you don't overuse them. So our first tagline is Mountaineers Go First. That is the spirit and the title of our campaign. But we also have a secondary campaign or a secondary tagline called Let's Go. And for those of us who are Mountaineers, those of us who have been here, when I say let's go, there you go, right? So there's a history there that when you see that, for those of us who've been here, we know that that has a special meaning. For those who perhaps are prospective students and are checking us out, it still has a resonance, it has a forward thinking and sort of an energy about it. But when they get here and they hear let's go Mountaineers, then they're like, oh, I get it. So we don't want to overuse let's go. It has to be very intentional in its audience. But Mountaineers Go First is the one that you'll see, but you won't see it being used over and over and over. We're very judicious in where we use it. typography. So remember that one slide that I had lots of different brochures up and there were lots of different fonts? We've narrowed everything down really to two, to Helvetica and some different styles there, as well as Iowan Old Style. So again, we have lots of different audiences. So one font, one look and feel is not going to work for everyone. So we built it on a spectrum. So if we are talking to prospective students, you're going to head over toward the more bold style. You're going to use bigger fonts and bigger text. If we have an alumni publication that's coming out or some sort of donor relation material perhaps, you're going to slide over towards the more traditional side, right? So it's one of those things where it's not one way or the other. As I've talked about the brand with different folks, what I've said is it's a lot of gray, unfortunately. And as you roll out a brand, there's tweaks and things that you make and work with so that everyone feels good about it. But the spectrum itself should really help you slide across that so you can really tailor your look and feel to whatever audience you're trying to reach. Photography. So I meant to put another slide in and I didn't have time, but my team knows that one of my biggest pet peeves is that we have thousands and thousands of beautiful pictures of Woodburn Circle with no people in them. Right? I mean, I hear laughter, right? Everyone has seen the pictures of beautiful Woodburn, but no people. We really have to show our people because that's where our strength is, and we have to show that there's action and energy and all sorts of great things happening here. So we'll still have great pictures of Woodburn, but they'll have people in them. And what we'll do is we'll divide our category of photography into three. So we have what I call in the moment, where you see people working. I don't necessarily need to see happy, smiling people all the time. I need to see them engaged, and they're really engrossed in their work, because that shows that people are really involved and interested in what they're doing. Doing here. I also want to see interaction, and that may be anything from working in a lab to working with your professor to getting a selfie with Dr. Gee. And I recommend you do that tonight if you see him. So you'll be on the Twitter page. But what we want to do is show how we interact with our folks and what are the different things that we do here at the university that other schools may not do. So I know many of you may have seen recruitment materials or other imagery where you've got, you know, three kids walking and they have on their branded sweatshirt and their books on the right and the backpacks on, and those are things we don't want. We want to show the true student and the true activity that happens at WVU. And the third is sense of place. So this goes back to a little bit that came out of our research, is that we are in beautiful West Virginia, and we are surrounded by gorgeous mountains and beautiful lakes and rivers, and we have not really promoted that as we should. So coming from Indiana, I can guarantee you that I don't see this when I walk out of my door in Indiana, right? It's very flat. We have lots and lots of cornfields. And this is a gorgeous place. And so what we want to do is let people know that if you come here, not only are you going to get a great education, but if you do like rock climbing, you can also rock climb around here. And if you do like kayaking, which I have to say I tried for the first time last weekend, that was an experience for someone who really likes concrete. But anyway, if you want to try it, it can be great fun as well. And if you just enjoy looking in the mountains, it's equally beautiful. So one of the things that we really want to do is really show that we have a sense of place as well as a sense of purpose. Color palette, again, we'll stay with our blue and gold. Nothing is changing there. But we have created what I call a secondary or an alternate accent palette for designers so that they have some wiggle room as they're working with things. I don't want everything necessarily to be blue and gold. That should be your primary colors. But there are some other secondary colors that you can use to help elevate your pieces. And again, it's all about flexibility, right? So we may have pieces that look more bold, we may have things that look more traditional, and there may be some things in the middle. But all of it needs to have a similar look and feel as we begin to put materials out there. So, how everything comes together, I thought I would bring some things that we've been working on as well as preview for you some things that are in the works. So, the viewbook. This is one thing that we're working on right now. We've got a couple different cover options there. What we've had in the past is about a 24-page viewbook that really talks a lot about the student experience. There's lots of student profiles. Whoops, that thing just keeps coming up, doesn't it? All right, there we go. It talks about student profiles and lots of information, but sort of buried. I thought it was very hard for us to figure out what the university was about when we looked at last year's view book. This one is going to be much more robust. And we have on the cover a very simple flying WV because on the inside we're going to begin to make a little impact. So I'm going to wait just a few seconds and let you guys read that. So if you're a prospective student or a parent of about to be a prospective student, how did that make you feel when you read that?
Where do I sign up?
There you go. I like that. Okay. It's meant to be inspiring, right? It's meant to help really serve as that foundation and that opening spread of if you come to WVU, it's like an experience like it's like no other. And we're not going to do everything for you. It's going to be up to you, but we'll help you carve out that path and we'll help you make your way. And then we get to the inside spreads. One of the reasons we have a more simple cover is two reasons, really. The first is that inside is chock full of great photography and great imagery, so we didn't want to necessarily compete with that. Also, when we did sort of a test of what's out there, lots and lots of viewbooks out there have pictures on their cover. They have scenery, they have students, they have faculty and students, they have a lot of different options, and we thought, well, we stand out a little bit different if we did not have the same sort of photography on the front. But here what we begin to do is really take a step back from a lot of these big student profiles and big stories and throw lots of information at them in little tidbits. So we talk a little bit about what kind of our first do we have. You know, we have one of the best crime scene labs in the country. We're doing great work with neuroscience and research with brain cells. Our engineering students had a great hybrid electric vehicle that won, you know, major contests. So we have all these lots of great things, and we're trying to put them into a package that really lets them see at a quick pace what all there is to do here. This is a spread that is a sample of what College of Creative Arts might look like. Every single college and school will be represented in the main viewbook this year. So that's a little different too. And what we're doing then is the colleges and schools will have their own that will supplement. So we obviously can't get everything on two pages of what each school and college represents. But that book that they create will help supplement for our prospective students exactly what they offer. And again, lots of little tidbits and information, all the majors and minors, et cetera. And we don't want to lose the spirit, right? So we have lots of pages that talk about innovation and about entrepreneurship, about our faculty and research as well. But we also want to make sure they understand that they are at a Big 12 institution and they're going to have a great college experience. So this shows what it's like to be out there when the football team is playing and when you're a part of that crowd, as well as another page that really talks about some of the other sports that we have here and how you can become engaged with that and what our student athletes are really like. That's one of the things that we're looking at as we begin to roll the brand into different areas. How do we begin to elevate those areas as well? In athletics, we have great teams, but we also have fantastic student athletes. So how do we begin to raise them up as well? And of course, we'll end with a couple call to actions and our tagline, Mountaineers Go First. So there's a few sample pages from there. How that then plays into the college-specific pieces, this is an example of what a college view book may look like. So for the College of Creative Arts, it really talks about, again, big photography, big bold fonts, and it says, we're the original pioneers crafting one of a kind from nothing but our imagination, some paint, plaster, and a few thousand pixels. This is where ideas come first. So that same sort of messaging, photography, and strong language, and inviting language really pushes down into the colleges and schools as well. Our websites in the fall is when we'll begin to renovate many of our websites, if you will. That was one thing we pushed off a little bit. So we'll begin to look at this again, the bigger photography, looking at simplifying. Right now, if you go to our website, it's a little cumbersome. We make people work really hard as we navigate around, so we're trying to really streamline those things as well. And then we brought a few ads to show you how we began to put this into the marketplace. A lot of these are really aimed at recruitment at this time. That's our strongest drive of how we're launching out the brand. And here's a few others that we did as well. We ran a version of our manifesto, if you will, that really helps define the brand for people. We ran that in the beginning of February many, many times. We also launched in February 2nd is when everything launched, and I said that we were doing an internal launch first for two reasons. One, because again, it's all about family first and really telling people what we're all about and why we're doing this. But second, it's cold in February, right? Nobody really wants to be out and about doing things outside. So we really brought all the brand things into the colleges and schools and into the places where students hung out. And these are the banners that really help to define the brand and let people understand the language and the feeling behind it. We also went into each college and school and began to really think about what are those things that are important to your college? What are the things that really set you apart? And we began to put up pull-up banners in their public spaces so that as their students and their faculty and staff came in, they began to see, oh, yes, I understand how we are part of this bigger university and what are those things that make our college and school special as well. The next version that the people will begin to see out within the colleges and schools as fall begins to approach is we're taking it in and really beginning to talk about the people and the folks that really make this place special. So here's a couple examples. This is someone, I can't remember her name right now, Cheryl Ball, I believe, who won WVU's first Mellon Grant. So we want to really raise that profile up and let her peers and her students know. This is Sarah Blair, who's elected as our youngest lawmaker in the nation. And so she's in the B&E College, so we want to make sure that they understand that one of their own students has really done something first, not only within the state, but within the country. So they'll begin to roll those banners out in the fall. And then we're doing some really big building banners. This is one that will come out a little later, but after you're all done here, hopefully you'll meander into the main circle, because these were drafts of what we thought they might look like, but they're actually up and out and about now, so be sure to go out and take a look. But we have a couple big banners that we're putting onto our buildings to really help inspire folks. We have, starting on Monday, hundreds of students coming in for new student orientation for the month of June and into July, and so we wanted to make sure that all of these things were up so that as they came in, they understood what WVU is all about, and we could really get them into the spirit. We also put some new street banners up as well. You know, this one was still going up as I drove in. Hopefully it'll be up soon. But there on the side of the layer, again, is sort of our manifesto that really helps people to inspire, feel inspired, and understand what WVU is all about. And as our creative people call it, there's Climby Guy. So he's also up there on the board. People will see him and hopefully be inspired to climb a little higher as well. This is some work that will be done later this summer up the stairs. Back behind us, you'll be able to see parts of the manifesto and the words that really drive the brand as people walk up those stairs. And then also we're taking the brand and moving it into lots of different arenas. So this is the International Science and Engineering Festival, which just happened a couple weeks ago up in Pittsburgh. We had a huge booth display. According to my reports that came back, we blew them out of the water, which is exactly what we wanted. But we had a big booth space, again, branded with the words, branded with our imagery. We had lots of different things and activities that tied back to science and engineering here. And who knew that buttons were still popular with kids? So I did not. And so my team came and said, I really think these buttons would be awesome. And I'm like, okay, are buttons still cool with teenagers? I don't know, we'll find out, let's go for it. So they crafted, for this particular event, they crafted 6 to 8 different buttons that really tied into the activities that students would be interested in. So example, rocketry or engineering, robotics. And what we found is that the kids not only love these, but they were very specific. So if they found a robot and they said, oh, I'm not into robotics, but you are, and then they traded. And so they were, you know, trying to really get the right buttons and had a great, great time with them. So we're also doing this as we roll out the campaign. We're doing a lot of things over the summer. We have crafted a card that looks like the state of West Virginia and have a couple different buttons on them as well. So I brought some for everyone. If you want some buttons to take back, you can trade amongst yourselves. But we have some fun things here that we're beginning to put out into that student population as well as the state. These are some other pieces, just to give you a flavor of how it's really beginning to get into the print material. You'll see lots of the diagonal lines, lots of the big bold college or big bold fonts, and lots of big bold photography as well. This is a piece that we send to our juniors who are in high school considering WVU and other colleges. We talk about what they need to be doing as they head into their senior year. So again, you see sort of that consistency in look and feel. And I'm going to break back out and show you some different things that we've done on social. So one of the things that we did early on with our students in particular is we went to Twitter and we did really quick video clips of how are you going to go first. So one of the things that we've talked about is Mountaineers Go First doesn't necessarily mean that we're first in everything, but what do you want to lead at? What do you want to be known for? What is it that you're going to take out into the world? So we have a few to show you here.
My name is Ethan Ball, and I want to be the first Mountaineer to meet all 30,000 people on campus. The education is definitely the most important part of college, but the connections you make go so much farther beyond that.
So really quick,
My name is Ethan.
See him again. We had about 20 of these that we played on Twitter. We just rolled them out over a couple weeks span, and we got huge response to them. People really enjoyed listening to our students.
My name is Joy Wong, and I want to be the first Mountaineer to find a cure for Alzheimer's disease. My grandmother suffered from degenerative mental dementia, and my family and I had to watch her suffer through her illness. And the pain that my family and I experienced is something I don't want anyone else to have to go through.
So that was one of the most popular that had a lot of feedback on Facebook. And if you notice, even within these little videos, we balance that spirit and that academic side, right? So we have a student who really wanted to have some fun here and try and meet all 30,000 fellow students. But we had another young woman who really was here for a purpose because she had a mission to solve something that had really affected her family. And then as we begin to move through the year, we kept thinking, how do we branch this out into different ways, right? So we just came off of commencement, and we had the same idea that we took to our graduates.
My name is Philip Pham, and I want to be the first mountaineer to travel the country and give people new smiles.
My name is Amber Bauer, and I will be the first college graduate in my family.
My name is Michael Beckley, and I'm running from Atlanta, Georgia. I'm going to be getting my Master's of Public Health, and I'll be the first mountaineer to be elected to the Georgia State Legislature.
I'll be the first mountaineer to go to Hampton in Saudi Arabia.
My name is Chioma Okemua. In 15 years' time, I hope to be the Director General of NADAC Nigeria, that is the National Agency for Food and Drug Administration.
My name is Julian Parks, and I'll be the first mountaineer to put an end to terrorism.
My name is Nadine Ahoy, and I hope to move back to Ghana in 3 years to go start my own tutoring, mentoring, and daycare institution to help underprivileged kids get the different benefits that I did when I was growing up.
My name is Skylar Harbath, and I'm going to be the first mountaineer to report globally for 60 minutes.
My name is Yong Sophia Puma. I'm going to be the first Malaysian Muslim mountaineer to be the best CEO of the best company in the world.
I still get chills every time I see that. I just love that clip. So we integrated lots of the things that we've been doing at the launch of the brand into commencement, and as we're moving through into the summer, we'll continue to do these sorts of videos and build out a great little microsite that we're currently working on. So back to wrap everything up. So how it all rolled out. So in January, we had lots of trainings and workshops in creative development, and really made sure that we had all the tools and resources needed for our folks who are going to work with this as we began to launch. In February, as I mentioned, we had an internal launch that really talked and focused in on our own internal campus community and our alumni family. In May, we're going to begin more of a statewide launch. We're going to have a county tour again with Dr. Gee. Last year, he visited all 55 counties during the summer, and we're going to do the same, only half this year. So we're doing about 30 to 35 counties, and we're going to be sure to take all of these messages and some of these fund collaterals and things like that out into the communities that are within West Virginia. Before we get there, we might be doing some ads, so we're beginning to really showcase this in a bigger way within the state. We're also going to work at increasing our earned media, so again, our stories will focus and begin to really take on more of a life within the brand as we work with our media, and also our extension offices. So we have a county extension office in every single county, and to me, that's a front door to WVU in every single county of our state, and we need to maximize that the best we can, because for many of our students who come here, that's often their first experience with WVU. So whether they're at a 4-H camp or they're coming to some sort of session within that county extension building, that is a powerful relationship building experience. And so I want to make sure that they are branded well, that they have the tools and the resources they need to not only be great ambassadors for WVU, but to be good recruiters for us as well. And then in August, it really kicks up. We move more into the regional. That will really tie in a lot with our student recruitment. We have worked very closely with our admissions office to really talk about the experience of when we have different events, to when we do our materials, and when we go out and about. How do we make sure that we take the same WVU out to our prospective students? Our alumni chapters will begin to work with them more, because they are also a great extension of our brand. And often, all across the country and the world, they are talking about WVU. So I want to make sure they have the same message points and the same look and feel in their materials. More national ads will play. We placed earned media op-eds, and we'll begin to really look at some targeted sponsorships. So like the ICEF material that you saw earlier, we're looking at what sorts of sponsorships do we do, especially tied to student recruitment. Where are those at, and what makes the most sense for us to be at, and really create a bigger presence and begin to really show the university in a new light. So that sums it up, and I'm happy to answer questions. Yes.
Got what did this election have?
Sure. I'll answer that one first. So we did do a lot of focus groups. We had actually two campaigns that we looked at and two taglines. I didn't want to have too many, because when you give too many options, then you're all over the board. So we really focused it down to two, and we did lots of focus groups. We did some surveys, but it really was getting lots of people together and having them come in and take a look at it. We showed them, you know, that sort of brand trailer. We had some created for each of the two different campaigns, so they saw it visually, they saw some sample materials, and they saw the taglines incorporated into that. So it was really through focus groups that we tried to make sure that all of our constituencies had some sort of voice with that. In regards to the website, don't mislead that we didn't necessarily think about the websites. We actually have two under development right now. So as far as rolling things out, nothing will roll out until July and August, but we didn't launch with the website only because there was so much work to do there. So it was a matter of, do I begin to roll out the brand in different ways and get people excited, or do we wait and, you know, hold it till everything's ready? So we began to do more of a gradual launch with that instead. We did have a website up as far as tools and resources and those sorts of things that people could go to, but we're overhauling the main site, and we're overhauling the entire admissions process site, so not just admissions, but financial aid, all the touch places that students might go when it comes to admitting to WVU. We're overhauling all of that for a July 1 launch. So that was some of the rationale behind that. Mm-hmm. Yes? No, I have to say, actually, I didn't feel much resistance. I think as we began to do those initial conversations, and then I came back together with everyone, and we have a Dean's Council meeting that I went to, and I just said, here's sort of what I found, and here's the next step. So I first gave them my impression of, I'm hearing these sorts of things, and I don't think we're on the same page. We need to really come together. And then we went out and did the research, and all of that really validated those feelings, and that this is how we're projected out in the marketplace, and if we don't begin to switch how we do things, we're never going to move forward in a really big way. So the data helps. You know, it's one of those things, again, if I had just come in and said, look at this fabulous campaign without any sort of data behind it, I think it would have been a harder sell. I also have a great group of campus communicators, and I have a great group of deans. I have to say this is one of the most fabulous places to work. I have such a great support team from top to throughout the entire university. And so they are very helpful. If something doesn't resonate, they tell me. If something isn't seeming to work, they tell me, and we just work on it together. I tell folks over and over again as in the university that we're in this as partners. It is not me and university relations saying, thou shalt do this. It is, we are going to do this together, and you need to let me know what works and what doesn't work, and how do we make it so that everyone feels really good about it. The other sort of caveat or key that I had in my pocket was I had President Gee, who loves this university and is so adamant and passionate about marketing and communication and making sure that we do things right, that I knew I always had his support as well. And so that's very key. If you don't have that support of that upper administration or those upper executives that really are behind you and support you, then it is more of a challenge. But I definitely had a team that was behind all the efforts that we were putting forth. Yeah. Yes, right here first, then I'll go here. Well, and I did not give props to the folks who helped us with that. So we had teams outside of the university team that helped us create this. We worked with Ology, which is a creative agency out of Ohio. We also worked with Widmeyer Communication to help us do the research. So Widmeyer did the research and went out there and gathered all the data for us, you know, based on what the things I gave them that I wanted to learn or wanted to try and get a better gauge of. And then we brought that information back, met with the creative team and said, okay, let's take a look at all of this. And that's where the interviews came into place. That's where the focus groups came into place. And then they began to help me sort sort of glean, these are the things that I think are key, these are the things I think could be secondary, and then begin to package that in a different way. So I too leaned on outside insight, because I think too, a lot of times when you only rely on yourselves, you're skewed in your vision, right? Because you've been here a long time, or you see things the same way, or you think you know what it should be. And I wanted to make sure I had outside voices saying, yes, you're on there, and no, we think you're off over here, and what really is the right positioning. So I think having that outside help really is going to benefit. But it is, you're right, overwhelming when you start getting it all in, and it's like, wow, how do you manage that? And that's where those sort of numbers people and all those things that can build that data really comes into play for me. Yeah. Yes?
Do you have a component that addresses town-gown relations? Because that's always so critical for universities, especially some of the size of the view. Because I think the university has done a really good job at tamping down on the party school aspect, especially with Princeton Review and Playboy. But, you know, what do you do the first time, you know, there's a victory in the fall and there's a couch being put on the street?
We don't burn couches here. that's just a misnomer. Yes, so we do have lots of town gown relations. It's not necessarily out of my area per se, it's with our government relations, but we work very closely with them. So there's a lot of behind the scenes work with our council members and commissioners that work with the university as a whole. Dr. Gee is also very key in helping to develop those relationships and changing some of those mindsets. From my perspective, where I kind of come into play is working with our hometown newspaper. So we often get some really negative press from them. And so for me, it's constantly working and saying, well, here are some other great stories. And yes, we did have this unfortunate incident. So we call the game last year against Baylor the night of unfortunate incidents. We don't talk about it in big ways, but we got some national press off of that because of the things that they did. We had a lot of damage to the town. We had the burnings, the couch burnings and such, and what we did is we reacted really quickly. And I think that's the big thing, is if something like this happens, you own it, you take charge of it, and you come out really strong. And Dr. Gee was one who said, we're not going to tolerate this anymore, and here's what we're going to do. And so, you know, on Twitter, things were really flying around really quickly. So one of his first statements actually came out on Twitter before the official press release went out with our statement. And then we just kept hammering that all semester long of what kinds of things we're doing to help really reset the institution. And we really went to the students too, because that's why I think one of the things that is important in town gown relations is it's not always the administration working with council or whoever it may be. It's really how does the student interact with that city population as well. And we have a great new student body president who is advocating for a seat on the council, a non-voting seat, so that we can take that student voice and he can take their voices back. So it's all about trying to figure out what are the best ways to really develop that relationship and how do you work at it from every single angle. So I think really when we have an unfortunate incident, we just come at it really quickly. And you know, those who were involved may not be with us anymore, and those who weren't, they need to step up and not accept it. Yeah. Yes? Sure. I don't like the word policing either, but you tend to do that. And I told our teams that I'm not a micromanager, but they're going to feel like I am for the next few months because I am sort of watching and looking at everything to make sure that we are consistent. I think part of it, again, goes back to our campus communicators that live within the colleges, schools, and units, that they are extension of my unit and that they need to help me take that brand into their departments and help explain it. I think it also is a good partnership with the dean so that when you hear from your dean, we need to do this. And if that needs to be changed, then you know they understand the whys behind it. So it really is, again, it's not about policing or monitoring. It's if I see something that isn't right, then we just have a conversation and say, hey, next time let's do it this way. And if you need my team's help, then we'll be happy to do so. And it's about making sure that all of the communicators that I have within the university are really able to understand the brand and know they can come and ask for help if they need it. And really it extends beyond Morgantown too. So we're working a lot with our divisional campuses is how in the next, you know, 6 to 8 months do we begin to take the brand maybe a little bit into the divisionals? How do I take it to extension? We're working with health sciences and with the hospital because there's some rebranding going on there to be more consistent with the university. So there's lots of pockets where we've sort of been siloed, if you will, again, of how people have done things their own way for a long time. And it's really about bringing everyone into the fold. And it's going to be a slow process. I mean, I see it a good year and a half before we feel like things are really in a good groove and people understand and can get things done in a quick way. Yeah. Yes?
Those on campus who market to students who are already on campus, so some of your interns and others, and And then the other part of that was to kind of piggyback on that. And if you could just talk a little bit about what that structure of your campus communicators looks like, if it's, if you have a lot of divisional people or if you have a lot that are in those individual units.
Sure. So how we mark, the first question was how do, what was your first question again? Sorry.
how do you work with those who market to the students who are internally already?
Right. Okay, so how do we internally market to our students? And I think, again, that's an area that we've had a good foundation, but we haven't been really strong at. So one of the things that we're beginning to look at for the fall are lots of the fall activities and things that we do. How can we sort of ramp up some of those marketing efforts, and how do we tie the campaign into it? So really, we're at probably starting line for some of those things. One example is one of the programs that Dr. Gee has rolled out is Project 168. And the theory behind the program is that you are in class for 18 hours, so what do you do with the other 150? And that's what really makes up your college and campus experience. And so Project 168 is really talking about how do you look at your academic life, your personal development life, and your professional development life. And so one of the things that my team is doing is taking a look at that project. How do we begin to visually express that? How do we begin to talk about it? And within that particular program, we'll begin to market more internally to our students. So that's how we're going to be kicking that off in the fall. How my team is structured, we have a team about 60 to 65 within University Relations, which is comprises design, writing, video, website, visitor center, trademark and licensing. So we have a really big breadth of folks. But then within each college and school, there are communicators. And then within, say, Extension, there's a communicator that's a lead. Within the Alumni Association, there's a communicator. And so I bring everyone together once a month, and we talk about the big issues that are kind of happening, and then we do rounds so that we hear what's happening in everybody else's area, and sometimes people connect and go, I didn't know you were doing this, we were doing that, and so they get together. So it's really about just keeping our communication open as best we can, and I know that if I have an issue or that if I need support in an area, I can call that communicator, and they'll work with me and my team to make sure that we get whatever needs to be done. So it's all about communication, which sometimes we communicators are not the best at, right? So it's really trying to keep everybody on in the loop as best we can. Yes?
Can you speak to the complexity of content strategy from the web perspective, kind of the level of effort and how you're generating all the content across the university?
Sure. So we're actually in reconstruction mode with that, if you will, as well. So when I got here, we had a university editor, we had a couple of different writers, and then we had everybody else writing lots of different things. And what I have found really quickly, one of the things that we wanted to create was a messaging site. So if a dean was going to go out and talk about, you know, a topic of his area, but he wanted some key points about perhaps what's happening on the legislative side of life at the university, where would he find that information? So we wanted to create this site so as people went out and did presentations, they had information at a really quick resource they could go to. It took us, I had hoped for it in 2 to 3 months, it took us almost 7, because the information was so spread out all over the university, and we are still struggling with that. So what we're doing is actually redesigning the team a little bit away from editors and writers into content strategists. We'll have one director who will lead that. All the content that comes in from our university's communicators will go through that person, and then she'll be able to go, oh, this is a great story for online. Oh, this would be a great video. Oh, this would be great for our prospective students, and really begin to manage that. So we're really still in the beginning stages of that. But you're right, there is so much out there. I learned really quickly it was going to take a lot to really wrap that and try and make it flow in a really sensible way and one that works for us in a quick way. Yeah. I think there was a question up here. Yes. Okay. So Widmeyer Communications, we had a relationship here at WVU with them for a long time, so we looked at a couple different places, but I felt very comfortable that they knew us and we knew them and that they could work pretty quickly. We launched with our research in May, and we wrapped up the last bit of research in early August. About the same time in July, I began to bring in Ology. Ology, I had a relationship with back at Purdue. We'd worked with them when I was there. We did go out on bid and had 5 different companies present to us, but I stepped back because I knew it was a little prejudiced, but the team still felt Ology had the best fit for us, so that's how they were selected. And then what they did is they began to see some of the beginning research coming in. They began to do their focus group interviews, and then as that final batch was in, they began to really delve into that. So it was from May until November. November's when I presented the final presentation to our Board of Governors and got their blessing, and then another couple months to educate and train staff and communicators, and then launched in February. So from May to February. Yeah. Yes. And I think we're at time. So I'll be in the back if you have other questions. Happy to answer more. But thank you so much for your attention and your time.